White supremacy. A tribute to Dr. Francis Cress Welsing and Mr. Nelly Fuller. As long as white supremacy is alive and well, a white man's heaven is a black man's hell. Uncle Sam and Jim Crow are the arch deceivers of the game, and that old skinhead Ku Klux spirit is still the same. As a man-child of the sun, I've got melanin on my mind. Can't afford to be simply deaf, dumb, and blind when white supremacy is the bottom line. And as long as white supremacy is alive and still kicking ass, freedom, justice, and equality will never come to pass. Many look, but few ever really see. The most unjust dynamic in the world is white supremacy. Hi, I'm Danny Queen, and welcome to another edition of Color Me Poetry. I'd like to welcome my most illustrious guest, the Honorable Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. Welcome,
Dr. Welsing. I'm glad to be here, Danny.
Uh-huh. Tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got started in your career.
Well, I am a general psychiatrist and child psychiatrist. I'm from Chicago, but I have been in Washington, D.C. since 1958 when I came to medical school at Howard University. And did all of my training in general psychiatry at St. Elizabeth's Hospital and child psychiatry at Children's Hospital here in Washington. And I have been interested. Things didn't start out that way, but I became interested in how to solve the mental health problems and other health care problems faced by black people. And I began to realize that until the problem of racism was solved, that black people were going to have difficulty as far as their health collectively, totally, is concerned. And I made up my mind, let me find out about racism.
Now, how many of your colleagues agree with you? How many know what you're saying is true and agree with you?
Well, I don't think I understand your question, mm-hmm. but that's not an important consideration. Mm-hmm. In other words, when you step into new territory, the reason that you have to step into new territory is because other people haven't been there before you. So it would be like asking Einstein, if you will, mm-hmm. well, do your colleagues agree with relativity theory? He felt that there was a vacuum in an area of understanding. He moved into the vacuum. Eventually, people caught up to what he had in mind.
As I find that as an artist, sometimes it's like that too. Because sometimes, not that you intend to be, but sometimes you have a tendency to be ahead of the pack, if you will.
Well, that you may not. You see, mm-hmm. the artist who may step in a new direction doesn't say, "I am going to step into a new mm-hmm. direction to be ahead of the pack." No, mm-hmm. they are inspired or motivated or moved as an individual person to go in one direction, mm-hmm. and it then becomes apparent that they are ahead of the pack.
I know. For instance, I did a piece in my book called South Africa some time ago. And at the time when I wrote it, some 10, 12 years ago, it wasn't at the forefront.
Exactly.
And now you see the changes coming about and stuff.
Exactly.
But at the time when I wrote that piece, I wasn't thinking, oh, I'm gonna be ahead of.
Exactly.
I wasn't even thinking in terms of that at all.
Well, as I move around, whenever I move around the city and I started writing about racism effectively or thinking about it intensively in 1967 and started mm-hmm. talking about it openly from 1970, following my writing about the Cress theory of color confrontation and racism, white supremacy. And now, whenever I move about town, I could be in Woody's, I could be at Union Station, I could be on the street, somebody might come up to me and say, let me shake your hand, or you don't know me, but I started hearing you talk in 1970, and I knew you were crazy. Do you see? But now, 20 years later, I understand what you were talking about. And so that's very interesting to me to have people say that, but it meant that you were talking about something in a manner that was unfamiliar and people mm-hmm. couldn't connect with it. But as the flow of time moves on, do you see, then you become right on time as far as a larger number of people
are concerned. So at the time when you were working at Howard, people thought you were very radical and all.
You mean when I was teaching at Howard University? Mm-hmm. Well, my experience at Howard, because I had gone to medical school there and, knew the people who were on the faculty and they knew me as a student, I taught there from 1968 to 1975. And people didn't, they considered that I was Francis Cress or Francis mm-hmm. Cress Welsing. And I don't feel that they felt generally that I was that radical person. Maybe I became after other people said, well, she's radical. Okay, then we have to look at this person who we are very familiar with as being this radical.
And now?
Person.
Now it's a lot different. Because a lot of things that you had said back then had come to pass.
Well, this is what people say.
Mm-hmm. Mm, wow. Let's talk also about your theory.
The Cress theory?
The Cress theory.
Well, the Cress theory is a thesis about racism, white supremacy. And as I was explaining earlier, I got involved in this thinking when I was doing a residency in general psychiatry at St. Elizabeth's Hospital and encountering black patients that essentially had been cast to the side. You know, we're not really interested in the black patient. We're interested in other kinds of patients, namely white patients. And I don't think that that is uncommon, you know, as we look back on our historic experience, that people were not zeroing in and being interested. I mean, one could translate that today when we have a lot of black young people, young male people who are getting into difficulty with drugs and guns. And nobody looks at them and says, I wonder why these children are having these problems. They just lump it in the category of being bad and crime-ridden. Mm-hmm. Do you see? So that same attitude was what prevailed generally when I began training in psychiatry. And so I started, wait a minute, I'm a third-generation physician in my family. My father was a physician, his father was a physician. And I grew up with the attitude that your responsibility as a physician is to address the medical and health needs of your people, people like yourself. Not that you would exclude anybody, but your priority responsibility. And so I, you know, started talking to black patients in a psychiatric hospital, and I became impressed by the fact that racism was causing great distress in these lives. I mean, the patient wouldn't say, I'm being impacted, doctor, by racism. But they would describe what they had experienced, do you see, and understanding, well, this is a product of racism. So that racism was causing depression, causing drug use, and other kinds of problems that patients face. And so I said, let me understand it to myself. I have to understand this if I'm going to really be effective as a physician. I mean, an effective physician doesn't just, oh, the patient has a cough. Oh, the patient is depressed, and write that down in your notes and give some medication. An effective physician, in my viewpoint, is a scientist who will say, what is causing this? Because only when you say, what is the etiology, what is the causation, can you move towards curing the problem and, most importantly, preventing it from going forward. And so I was looking for this answer and had the very good fortune of meeting Mr. Nelly Fuller, Nelly Fuller Jr., who is a citizen of the District of Columbia. And he, on his own, I met him following a Black Power committee meeting. That's back in the 60s, 1967, to be exact. And he was a person attending a meeting who, after I met him, I realized that he had been writing about this topic of racism going back to the Korean War when he was a soldier in the Korean War. And he said on a radar site in Japan, he started thinking about what was happening in the area of the world that we call the United States around the issue of color. And he started putting together his ideas. And when I met him and heard him talk about racism as a global system of power, where persons who classify themselves as white would maintain power over people who they classified as the non-whites, meaning the black, brown, red, and yellow people. And he said the system was operative in all areas of activity: economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war. And so that just blew my mind. I said, wow, that seems to be a very, very important idea. And after talking with him over a period of time, I started thinking, but why? Do you see? In other words,
why would they do this?
This is a new description of a very critical phenomenon on the planet Earth. I say that racism is the most important phenomenon that anybody can investigate and study. Not for the purpose of putting anyone down, but again, scientifically, this is a critical phenomenon that is impacting the lives of the vast majority of people on this planet in a negative way. And so if we're going to have justice on the planet, so therefore we can have peace, somebody has to probe deeply and understand this problem. And so he had outlined the system. And I guess as a psychiatrist who's always wondering about further about the why of behavior, so I thought, well, this seems to describe what I have experienced in my travels in the world, that you don't get away from racism. Racism is everywhere. If you go to Europe, it's there. If you go to Mexico, it's there. What would cause it? And that's how I got into my work, the Cress theory, by going, I would say, you know, I don't want to say deeper, but going to another level. Because Mr. Fuller, and this is his book, the textbook for victims of white supremacy.
Dynamic book, I must say,
a most powerful and dynamic book. And so I worked with him for from 1967 to 1984.
If I can
so that we could publish this book. And, you know, that was even something interesting. If somebody said, you work with this gentleman 17 years to make certain that his work is published, I would not have believed it at the time, but I was so impacted by the significance of what he had to say that I said, this has to be published. So we went through a number of twists and turns to bring it about, and it was a trip that took 17 years.
Wow.
But now the book is published, and I consider it to be one of the most important books of the 20th century. And my work just said, well, why would behavior be organized in this way, do you see, with white over non-white, or a tiny minority over the majority people on the planet? And I came up with the paper that's entitled The Cress Theory of Color Confrontation. Cress is my maiden name. I was married at the time. I think I was divorced, maybe. But I said, no, I will name this paper, give it my family name. And what I said in that paper is that the dilemma that the white minority population on planet Earth found itself in after we're sort of into now the voyages of discovery, the 500-year celebration of that.
Of the Columbus line.
But after persons, you know, came out of Europe and circumnavigated the globe, and Columbus was at the lead of persons from Europe circumnavigating the globe. It had been done by other people, but this was the first time for European people. And he found that every place, not Columbus, but the other people who participated in the voyages of discovery, found out that every place they landed, there were people of color. And they also found out in a very short period of time that the people of color were genetically dominant. In other words, if you mix black plus white, your product is going to be colored because of the genetic dominance of the ability to produce melanin skin pigmentation, and the genetic recessive character of the inability to produce melanin that allows skin to appear white or causes skin to appear white. And so that really is the basis of the Cress theory of color confrontation and racism. So once I pulled those ideas together, and it's a short paper, 13 pages initially, the Cress theory was, I began, it was like opening up a door where you see, oh, wow, I never thought about the problem in this way, but once I start thinking about the problem in this way, then many, many things become clear. You see patterns of behavior that just seem peculiar.
Things just come to you.
It became clear why we were seeing such things as lynching, what such things as justifiable homicide, such things as the inability to have gun control, or why people are interested in ball games. All of those things begin to become, oh, I understand this, within the framework of understanding racism, white supremacy in greater depth. And so I wrote a number of papers after presenting. The first paper I wrote was, as I said, The Cress Theory of Color Confrontation and Racism. And that paper was presented at the National Medical Association.
And you published this yourself.
And I published it myself. Do you see? And I advocate that. because I went to a couple of people.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Welsing, can we ask that you hold your point? We have to take a break.
We're
going to be right back.
Okay.
We're here with Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. We're going to be right back. We're going to take a break. It's Color Me Poetry.
A miracle in the making, forming eyes, fingers, and toes. A human fetus growing inside its mother. But even miracles need care, early and constant prenatal care. If you're pregnant, visit a doctor or a clinic now. This advice from the March of Dimes.
The developing baby is a miracle. But when the mother drinks, alcohol in her blood can hit hard, causing everything from minor abnormalities to fetal alcohol syndrome, with a range of birth defects, including mental retardation. We don't yet know how much alcohol is too much, but FAS can't happen if you don't drink. Warning, alcohol can be hazardous to your unborn baby's health, and we want your baby to be perfect.
Welcome back to Color Me Poetry. We're here with Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. Dr. Welsing, you were talking about the papers that went in to make the new book. The ISIS papers.
Well, I started with the Cress theory, as I've said, and then a number of ideas came to me as a result of the Cress theory. And so I wrote about those various topics, and they ended up being symbolic dimensions of the system of racism or the system of white supremacy.
So once you did the ISIS paper, it's kind of, as you might say, opened the floodgates for many other
ideas
on another whole nother level.
Right. But I never thought, well, I'm going to do a book. I would write papers and present them to my colleagues in psychiatry at the National Medical Association, which was a black medical association.
What would be their response?
Well, they would find it interesting. Maybe everybody didn't find it interesting. Maybe people said, oh, well, I don't know. I mean, you know, people many times don't come to you with their negative ideas. But many people were interested, and I ended up being one of the people that you'd have large numbers of people coming to if I was going to present a paper. People would look at the program, and a lot of people would come to hear the presentations. But over time, there were a number of papers, and so Third World Press, Haki Matabudi, encouraged me to put them together in a book. And I was not, you know, because the papers were never written for a large number of people. I thought the ISIS papers or the Cress theory, I thought about eight colleagues. I'm going to present my ideas about racism to eight colleagues in psychiatry. And then it turned out a lot of people became interested. And I had no idea that a large number of people would become interested in the essays that evolved from that. But a large number of people have become interested in Third World Press. Published the ISIS papers at the end of 1990.
Now, they published the Cress theory before that.
I published the Cress theory.
Oh, you published it. Didn't they publish excerpts from the Institute of Positive Education?
Oh, well,
it's interesting because, and that same issue, because I had the magazine, they sent it to me some time ago. But interestingly enough, excerpts from the ISIS paper, from the Cress theory are in there, and I did a poem in the same issue.
Oh, I see. So what year was that?
Oh, I really don't know, but I know.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, and then I meet you years later.
I see.
I did a poem called Ebony Lady.
Okay.
It was in the same issue, and I remember about 2 weeks ago, I was looking at that old issue, looking at something, and I saw an excerpt from the...
Right, that Institute of Positive Education did publish in their Black Books Bulletin.
And I was in the same issue as
some of the papers.
Right.
Okay, and then...
The Cress theory, as a matter of fact. Was in there.
I don't know whether the Cress theory was in that or not. I don't think so.
I remember.
Well, okay.
I can bring the issue and show you.
Because I know certain of the other papers were
And I found that very interesting.
So that's fascinating that it's coming together.
Yeah, and I was like, oh, wow, this is something. And I'll have to get that and show you to you.
Okay,
really quite
that'll
interesting.
Be interesting.
Oh, that was like some years ago.
Right.
Yeah.
We've been at this for a long time.
Yeah, well, you've been doing this more than 20 years.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. That's
so the popularity of the papers, of the first paper, which is the ISIS paper.
The Cress theory. A lot of people became interested in that.
Develop a following?
Well, you know, I'm not looking for a following. I'm trying to help people understand a phenomena that has caused great distress and great pain, and if we understand it, we can change it. So I wasn't interested in a following, mm-hmm. per se, but a lot of people have told me that the Cress theory changed their lives, and the people who have read the ISIS papers. I can't go anyplace, can't get on a plane. Maybe the stewardess will come up, aren't you the lady who wrote the Cress theory or the ISIS papers or something?
How does that make you feel?
Well, I'm always surprised. I'm always surprised. Because it wasn't, you know, mm-hmm. if I were an artist or, you know, a pop star or something like mm-hmm. that, then I would be trying to right. impact or have mm-hmm. people, oh, you know, Dr. Welsing, but that was not where the ideas came from. So I'm always impressed. Oh, people do understand.
Mm-hmm.
Or somebody does understand. Because, again, the my point and my priority is that if there is a problem on the planet, then responsible people will say we must help solve this problem for the well-being of the majority people on the planet so that everybody can live at the highest level of being humane or being human beings. I mean, that is the objective. At this point in time, we have the mass obscenity of death and dying and starvation and war and murder. I mean, I consider that to be a great, 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 great obscenity. And we cannot say that we respect human life, or we cannot say that we respect the planet and having human beings killed and destroyed at this level. So I believe that a group of people will come forward, individual people who will participate in solving this problem. People like yourself, you're writing all the time about That's problems right. and trying to impact the thinking of people. And I don't think this is for naught. I think that, you know, things take time. It takes time for a baby to be born.
That's true.
And it will take time for ideas to change or for you to reach a critical mass of people who have new thinking. Do you see the new thinking being planetary justice and planetary peace? And so I hope that the things that I've written will, you know, participate in achieving that objective.
Mm. I've shared your book with many friends, and the friends have said to me, well, this is too heavy. I can't read it all at one time. You know,
okay.
I have to read a little bit at a time and then come back. But I think it takes a while for some people to adjust to it because they haven't found people thinking.
See, it's a new way of thinking.
A whole new way.
It's a completely new way of thinking. Mm-hmm. about a problem. So it takes time, but I am impacted. I'm invited to speak on college campuses and at universities as well as other places. But when, I mean, it moves me almost to tears when, mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not a person that is breaking down and crying, but when somebody says, well, you know, young black people are not reading. Mm-hmm. But when these students come to me, Dr. Welsing, will you autograph my book? And I see a book that has been used up.
Like this one here.
you see, like you were right, Danny. That's wonderful.
Hey, I
you
hold
see,
this.
that's marvelous. I mean, that is a book that has mm-hmm. been read and digested, mm-hmm. and not necessarily doesn't mean that the mm-hmm. reader is agreeing with everything, mm-hmm. but people are reading the book and thinking, and this is marvelous. Mm. I mean, any book, do you see, any, you know, anything that is inspiring young people to read and to think, and to think about their lives, mm. and think about the world in which they live, and think about the universe. And so they get into it and turning the pages back and underlining in yellow and
like it's I did in this
almost
one.
Falling apart. And Dr. Welsing, mm. I had to buy a second copy. Somebody mm. took my first one. Well, I'm not, you know,
that.
I cannot condone the theft.
I
right,
the underlining
exactly.
Because I'm learning. I'm learning when I do that. That's a carryover from school, though.
You see, because I've been mm-hmm. a teacher, and I'm also, my mother was a Chicago public school teacher.
Okay.
So the whole idea about learning and reading, do you see, and wanting people to read and wanting people to think and digest ideas and to toss ideas back and forth.
Reading is very important.
Reading, 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 reading.
How well I know
reading.
It.
Right, okay.
As an English major, I know that
okay.
reading is very important. You
exactly.
suggest that we read at least
all
three
the
newspapers.
Time. Read three newspapers a day mm-hmm. so that you become surrounded by the ideas that are flowing in the culture. And also reading, you know, traveling, it's been very interesting to me. You know, if you travel to Ohio, you pick up newspapers in the airport, and well, what are the people thinking? And how do the people think about problems in this particular area? That is also
been
very important.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Also, I'd like to mention someone of Mr. Nelly Fuller's caliber. I mean, he's a gentleman, he don't have a degree in anything except common sense. But the society looks down on people who are not degreed, who don't have letters.
Well, sometimes people mm-hmm. might. Do you see, well, where did you go to school? Or where did you graduate? Mm-hmm. A degree doesn't mean that you have the capacity to think. It means that you've had certain opportunities. Mm-hmm. But people are born with incredible brain computers mm-hmm. that have the ability to think.
Malcolm X.
Well, there are thousands, you know, mm-hmm. millions of people
that you could
that are manifestations of this. So I just tell people, you know, I think that in the particular societal structure that we have, that a person who wants to maximize their opportunities will take themselves through the steps of getting credentials so that no one will say, well, you don't have this, and so therefore you cannot do. But it doesn't mean that those persons who have those credentials are the only people who have the ability to think. I consider Nelly Fuller to be one of the geniuses of our time. Now, he's a very modest person. He will object to my saying that and giving any kind of laudatory mm-hmm. praise, because he says the problem mm-hmm. that he is addressing, the problem of racism, white supremacy, has not been solved. And so none of us can really stand up for praise. We are people who are working on a problem. Mm. And we will see whether or not the ideas have great value if we are able to alter this problem.
If I can quote a line from Mr. Ford, he says, if you don't understand white supremacy, racism, what it is and how it works, everything that you understand will only serve to confuse you.
I agree with that. Do you see, because it's like a person who steps out on a football field and they think they want to participate in the action, but they don't understand the game. So they'll be confused
so you must understand
by what is happening. In the same way, unless we take our understanding of racism, white supremacy, to a greater depth, we will not be able to score, meaning to bring about those changes that we would like to see take place.
Mm. Dr. Welsing, for people who are interested in your books and lectures, where can we get your books?
Well, I think that Pyramid Bookstore mm-hmm. has carried the book, but I'm not involved in the mm-hmm. marketing end of it at all. That's
Is there a number or an address where we could write you?
Well, I'm in the DC phone book, but don't write to me asking me for the book. Do you see? Third World mm-hmm. Press in Chicago. Is where the book was published, and they probably could give the, you know, information about all the bookstores that they ship books to in the United States. Now, their number is 202-651-0700. That's Third World Press in
Chicago,
Illinois. But Pyramid Bookstores in Maryland and the District of Columbia have also been selling the book.
Mm-hmm. It's been great having you here on Color Me Poetry, and certainly wish you the very best. The book has done very well, and we wish continued success with the book. The book has been very well received. I know people coming to me and say, man, have you read that ISIS papers? I said, yeah, I read it, man. That's why my copy looks so rough.
Oh, well, I'm glad to see that.
Because I've shared it with many other people. It's good to see other people share their work with other people. And I think that raising the consciousness of our people.
Right.
So it's certainly been great having you here, and we're looking forward to having you back. This is Danny Queens, Color Me Poetry. And until next time, Color Me Poetry.
Hi, I'm Danny Quinn, and welcome to another exciting edition of Color Me Poetry this evening. It is my honor and my pleasure to welcome Mr. Nelly Fuller Jr. He's the author of the textbook workbook for victims of white supremacy. It's a short title, and Mr. Fuller has lectured extensively. He's traveled and spoken many places around the country, and I'd like to take this time to welcome Mr. Nelly Fuller Jr. Welcome, sir.
Good evening.
Let's talk about your book, your workbook, textbook, for victims of white supremacy. You started writing in the 50s, and you started when you were in the war, is that right?
No, actually it was, I first started thinking about it during the so-called Little Rock crisis at the Central High School there. And I was thinking about the terms that were being used, racial segregation, racial integration, and that became the focal point for my whole concept of the approach to racism, that the words are very important. And this became very important right at the beginning, that the words are being used, racial integration, racial segregation. What does this mean? What is racism? So over a period of time, taking notes that evolved into a book, it came to mean, to me, using what I call compensatory counter-racist logic, white supremacy. White supremacy is racism, racism is white supremacy, that they are synonymous because there possibly could be, in theory, other forms of racism, but that became the dominant form. And it grew out, according to using the same compensatory logic, it grew out of a need for a form of royalism on the part of a segment of the white population of the world.
That's very important that you say that, because most time when we think of racism, most people who use the term racism don't associate it with white supremacy.
No, it's associated very loosely with all forms of what people call bigotry, discrimination, prejudice. Actually, these words should not be within the context of what we call racism in order to provide focus to what you're talking about. When you use words like bigotry, discrimination, prejudice, racial segregation, these words do not accurately
describe
what you're really talking about as a function. The function is a system of white supremacy in all nine areas of activity. That's economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war. Now, these areas define what people do, or it addresses what people do. People are always involved in one or more of these areas of activity throughout the planet. That's all of the white and non-white people in the known universe. So the white supremacists, evidently, the people who first thought it up, thought of an idea of switching the old royal system, where you used to call it serfs, etc., switching that system to a system based on color. And it turned out to be one of the grandest and most powerful ideas, if not the most powerful idea, for manipulating people ever conceived. And it has been quite prosperous along those lines. It does get things done, but at a great cost of the mistreatment of people.
So that's very important that you put it that way, because it does, mistreating the people of color around the world. And that's not something to be taken lightly. But sometimes we, as I said earlier, we don't think of racism and white supremacy in the same breath. And that's part of the brainwash.
That's part of the strategy of the white supremacists themselves. Now, that doesn't say that all white people practice white supremacy, but all white people are expected to participate. And those who are not willing to participate run into problems with those who are willing to participate. And sometimes great fights down through history have broken out because of this. But those who believe in the system of white supremacy are far more powerful and smarter than those who don't.
I noticed on the back of your book there's a statement that says, if you don't understand racism, white supremacy, what it is and how it works, everything you understand will serve the confuse you. What do you mean by that?
Right. If you don't understand what white supremacy is and how it works, everything else that you understand will confuse you, because that is the dominant motivating force among the people of the known universe as it is today in all of the nine areas of activity. Mm-hmm. And it means that the white people who have decided to take part in this form of royalism, meaning racism, white supremacy, mm-hmm. want people to fall in line behind it and have actually done so. Now, those who don't, the white people who don't, they run into great difficulty. The non-white people, whether they are in direct contact with white people or not, they fall under the system, because the system takes in everything that people do every minute of every day, every place in the known universe. And if you don't understand this system, you won't understand anything else that's going on.
Is there any such thing really as black races or black racism or black supremacy? Because you hear people say those kind of things, particularly white people who call into radio stations and say, well, I think he's a black supremacist or he's a racist. Can black people be racist? Can people of color be racist?
Not within the system of white supremacy. That's one thing about understanding the entire system. The system of white supremacy as a system, as mm-hmm. a total system, has to be understood that it is indeed a total system. Therefore, someone who is subject to the system, which is any person, black, brown, red, or yellow, who is subject to the system, non-white people, cannot be subject to the system and be not subject to the system at the same time. You can't be a black supremacist and be subject to white supremacy at the same time. It is impossible. It can't be done. You cannot be a prisoner and a warden at the same time.
No, not possible.
You may aspire to be, which you shouldn't be, since the objective of counter-racism, which is what the book is about, is to produce peace and justice. Then you're not trying to establish another form of racism. You're trying to eliminate the form of racism that is in place.
So that's the basis upon which you said that white supremacy is the most unjust dynamic in the universe, in the known universe.
It prevents, the system of white supremacy prevents justice from being established. People often talk about justice, which means balance between people, which means guaranteeing that no person is mistreated, guaranteeing that the person that needs help the most gets the most help. That's what you might think in a compensatory fashion, mm-hmm. a truthful definition, an accurate and a functional, a productive definition of justice would be guaranteeing that no person is mistreated and guaranteeing that the person that needs help the most gets the most help. Now, you can't do this within a system of white supremacy, because the system of white supremacy is based on mistreatment. So therefore, if you automatically have mistreatment in place, an entire system based on mistreatment,
is that
in order for people to benefit an ego mm-hmm. trip or to benefit materially, then you cannot have justice within that system.
Mm-hmm. Is that the objective of white supremacy, basically to mistreat? Because people might say, well, why would they do this? Why would they think this way? Why would they set up such a system?
Well, it's an outgrowth of the basic royal concept that there are certain people who should be royal. And at one time, it was might have been, presumably, just among white people themselves. But when they came in contact with non-white people, then the old royal system switched over to a color system, which is much more efficient, much more dynamic, and it's proven to be the greatest political system and the greatest religious system in the known universe. It's the most powerful. Mm-hmm. It's an idea that has set off all kinds of ramifications among the body politic of the people in the known universe.
Let's talk about the first area of the nine concepts that you mentioned, which is it education, entertainment, labor law, politics, religion, sex, and war. Can we walk through each one of those briefly, so we can get an idea?
Well, economics means that the use of time and energy.
Okay.
And the racists, when they looked around at the people that they classified as non-white, they decided, well, one thing, we will have domination over the way that they use their time and energy. And all of these areas of activity are interrelated. Mm-hmm. Economics is interrelated with education. Education is interrelated with entertainment. Entertainment is interrelated with labor, law, politics, religion, mm-hmm. sex, war. All of these nine areas are interactive. So, if you're a white supremacist, in order to really be supreme, you have to get control over everything that people do in all of these nine areas if these people are classified as non-white. And of course, being a supremacist, the supremacist always does the classifying, not the victims. The victims cannot classify themselves without the approval of the white supremacists.
So they decide that you're black.
Sure. Just like a term that you hear now in popular parlance is the term biracial.
Yes.
Or multiracial.
Mm-hmm.
Or multicultural. Now, these are terms that the victims of racism will have to pick through and try to. They are given this selective chart where they can determine if they are biracial and to what degree of biracialism, whatever that's supposed to mean, what degree of colorism, whatever that's supposed to mean.
Yeah, because I understand that even coming up on, not yet, but coming up on the census forms, they're going to have different categories. I mean, it's not going to be just black, white, non-white, other anymore. It's going to be biracial and, you know, that kind of thing. How do you think that's going to affect?
More confusion. See, the basic reason, the basic tool of the races mm-hmm. is deceit.
Yes.
So therefore, deceit is supposed to produce confusion. The more confusion you have, the more deception you have among the victims. Now, the races will not be deceived. Mm-hmm. The white supremacists will be able to function as white people. That will still be their classification. The classification will be white. That's the dominant classification. Okay. All of the so-called biracial classifications will be more confusion. And a hypothetical situation would be that you would have then non-white people going into an employment office, making out forms where they will try to find out whether they are part Indian, part Portuguese, part semi-this and bi-that, and multi-this and multi-that. And it will take them all day probably to make out their form. Anyone who is classified as white will come in and maybe in a few minutes make out their applications and leave. The non-white people will still be there at closing time trying to figure out who they are and where they fit into the subordinate, and I underline subordinate, categories.
So it's basically, it's going to cause a lot of confusion for a lot of people. For a lot of people who consider themselves to be multiracial.
This is why it's important to always watch the words that are produced under the system of white supremacy. Any type of words that are introduced into the language, such as multiracialism, multiculturalism, biracialism. Take the term multiculturalism. Mm-hmm. Culture is what you do. That's all it is. Whatever people do in any one or more than nine areas of activity is the culture of that person at the time that the person is doing it, whatever it is that the person is doing. There's nothing mysterious about culture. The victims of white supremacy have a victimization culture all over the world.
We have to take a break right here. It's Danny Queen. We're speaking with Mr. Nelly Fuller Jr., and we're going to be back shortly.
You're watching BSU TV, Educational Access Television, Bowie State University. Channel 27A on Metrovision, 17B on Maryland Cable. In Prince George's County.
As long as white supremacy is alive and well, a white man's heaven is a black man's hell. Many look, but few see, that the most unjust dynamic in the world is white supremacy. Hi, welcome back to Color Me Poetry. I'm Danny Queen. I'm here with Mr. Nelly Fuller Jr., and we're discussing his book, Textbook for Victims of White Supremacy. Mr. Fuller, you have a long title here. Tell us about the title.
The United Independent Compensatory Code System concept. Mm-hmm. United means that in theory or in intent the people who are the victims of racism, mm-hmm. and or the white people who are against the proliferation or the continued use of racism as the standard for the world's business should be united against that standard. The independent part means that each individual mm-hmm. has to do what he or she can to counter racism with the ultimate objective of ending it and replacing it with a thing that we loosely call justice, ultimately leading to peace, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. Now that means that you're independent, you mm-hmm. are a independent
person. So it's not a collective effort.
It's collective in that you go to the third and fourth words, compensatory code. You become collective by using a code, mm-hmm. the code of compensation, making up. That's what compensatory means, making up for what's missing. Mm-hmm. Right, and you have a code to make up for what is missing. What is missing is the use of truth to produce justice and correctness, which theoretically would equal peace. So you come up with a compensatory code, a way of thinking, speaking, and acting each and every day in all of the nine areas of activity. Then you use that code as an individual, wherever you happen to be, in all of those areas of activity. And right now, it's only a concept. That's where the word concept comes in. See, it's strictly theory right now. You don't have a concept of white supremacy without the practice, because white supremacy is being practiced. Mm-hmm. A concept of the elimination of white supremacy and our racism and our injustice is strictly a concept. There's no such thing as justice existing anywhere mm-hmm. on the planet, since the definition for justice is guaranteeing that no person is mistreated. People are mistreated all over the planet all the time. So you just have a concept of justice. What you have is practical injustice. It's the difference between having a concept of justice and having it actually in practice.
Now here you say the people of the known universe, it says the people, just reading off the back, the people who have the ability to eliminate racism do not have the power to do so, and the people who have the power don't have the will or the ability to do so.
Well, that's obvious. Mm-hmm. If you are imprisoned unjustly, it means that you do not have the power to get out of prison because of two factors. You don't have the will or you don't have the ability. Now, those who are the victims of racism don't have the ability mm-hmm. because they do not have the will that provides the ability or the ability to provide the will to not be victims. Also, the racists do have the will and the ability to practice white supremacy. They have proven that.
Hmm. And that's why you say that there really can't be such thing as a black racist.
No.
Because it has to do with the ability to...
It has to do with the power relationship. It has to do with something that you're actually doing.
Carrying out. Mm-hmm.
You're actually doing it. White supremacy is a fact. A lot of people do not like to admit to its existence. But any comprehensive analysis would show that such a thing does exist. So therefore, you can't have a system of black supremacy within a system of white supremacy. It's a total contradiction.
Mm-hmm. Regardless of all that has been said or done, the quality of the relationship between black and white people is, and black and white people has been a total disaster.
Yes, it's a total disaster. What you mean by total is, at this particular point, it is total, because there is not a quality relationship between white people and non-white people on this planet because of the existence of the system of white supremacy. That cuts out any ability of anybody to produce a quality relationship between black people and white people. It also eliminates the possibility under the system of non-white people, black, brown, red, and yellow, interacting with each other, mm-hmm. or even with white people in a manner that is quality. By quality, we mean justice. We mean with truth. We mean doing the correct thing. You can't do it under a system of white supremacy, because the system of white supremacy is based on mistreating people and having the people react to that mistreatment. So what you have is just a lot of abuse and reactions to abuse and a continuation of the same. Now, you do accomplish a lot of technical things.
Such as?
Well, such as production of building of bridges, the building of highways, the building of buildings, of schools that, by the way, support the system of white supremacy.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And all of these things are designed to do just that. It's a giant ego trip for a white person to be told that because you're white, you are somewhat substantially royal, and so you should act like it. So that's a lot of incentive. Now, a non-white person sitting, say, in a classroom setting is told directly, indirectly, within the system of white supremacy, now you are being trained to be a victim of all of this.
So are you saying that that two students sitting in the same classroom can come out with, after 12 years of education, quote unquote, can come out with completely different concepts of themselves and different concepts of the society in which they live, even
within
though they're sitting
the
in the same
of white
classroom?
Supremacy, within the system of white supremacy, it is absolutely required. In other words, the white student is being taught systematically how to be a white supremacist. The non-white student is being taught how to be a victim. So you have an opposite right there.
In the same
classroom. In the same classroom at the same time. And the result is going to be that. Why? Because of the words that are used right in the classroom itself. The terms and the intent. This can be dismantled by changing the words, changing the way language is used, changing the way that things are glorified or not glorified. It cannot be offset by anything called Afrocentrism.
Okay. But by truth.
Yeah.
I've often heard you say that sometimes to get to truth, correct me if I'm wrong, it sometimes entails embarrassing black people and offending white people.
It's no way to talk about the system of white supremacy or racism in general without, as it stands now, without embarrassing black people and without offending white people. It's just no way to do it. But that goes with the territory of trying to solve the problem.
Why would black people feel embarrassed?
Because most people who like to feel that they have self-esteem and power, etc., are embarrassed when they find out that their self-esteem is very low, that they are really not very proud of themselves, that they really haven't accomplished anything that they can really point to that matters within the body politic of the system of white supremacy. So therefore, it causes a person to become embarrassed. A person becomes embarrassed when they sit in a classroom and they listen to the word dark being used. That's a non-white person. And just the way the word black or dark is being used in almost every setting or
even
context.
Even in the dictionary,
yes.
The way you look at the word black.
The student sits there and the student listens to words like dark ages. And you will say the person has a dark past. And you will hear that word being used repeatedly, dark, 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 within the context of something that is very demeaning, something that is very undesirable to anyone who has any sense of decency about them. So about the eighth or ninth grade, particularly black male students, simply do not want to hear any more of it. And so they become rebellious and disruptive.
They turn off.
And this is just one word, dark. But then when you include in that the glorification of events that have happened all down through history,
yes,
that were supportive of the system of white supremacy, then the non-white person loses self-esteem, loses the will to want to do anything within that class. Now, if we're talking about mathematics or biology, zoology, there are not so many problems in those particular classes if you have the support of the sociological classes,
okay,
the classes that deal with interactions between people. But when you don't have that support, the rest of it falls apart, mm-hmm, where the non-white student is involved.
Hmm. Most interesting. For people who are interested in contacting you or purchasing a copy of your book, how can we do that?
In the area, Washington, Maryland area, you can get it at bookstores such as Pyramid,
okay,
the North Star Connection in the Maryland area, and also Kariba Books, mm-hmm, in the shopping centers, also Yawa Books,
okay,
and certain other books that primarily feature what we call black literature.
Mm. There's so many things that we could touch on in the code book. But what is it that specifically that you hope to achieve, you know, with a book such as this?
I hope to achieve, first of all, being aware of racism, what it is, and how it works. And then to make prescriptions as to what an individual can do and say, mm-hmm, on a daily basis in all nine areas of activity so that they can counter what is already in place with the ultimate objective, not of establishing another form of racism or another form of mistreatment of people, mm-hmm, but with the objective, ultimately, of producing peace. And you can only do that through revealing truth and then using truth in such manner as to produce a product called justice and, mm-hmm, correctness. Correctness means balance between people and things, mm-hmm, creatures, etc.
And that's the way we get to it, because like you said before, there's a lot of people who we harbor a lot of pain and a lot of animosity for a lot of reasons. And sometimes people harbor these things against other people, don't even know why. Don't know that it has taken place.
That's true. The system of racism, any system of mistreatment of people, first of all, has to be designed so that you have automatic animosity toward another person. And so that person goes into a category where when you look at that person, you'll say, I am supposed to have animosity toward that person.
Mr. Fuller, thank you for coming and sharing with us here today on Color Me Poetry. We're going to have you back very soon. Is there a phone number, address, P.O. box where people can get in touch with you, maybe write you, or have you come and speak?
Yes. You can contact me through my phone number, which is 202-484-5461.
Thank you, sir, for coming and sharing with, mm-hmm, us. White supremacy. As long as white supremacy is alive and well, a white man's heaven is a black man's hell. Many look, but few see. The most unjust dynamic in the world is white supremacy. I'm Danny Queen. This is Color Me Poetry. And until next time, Color Me Poetry.
Species. The ugly ego of self-hate has since succeeded. Chocolate City's gone crazy. We gotta stop the madness. Everybody's out to lunch on crackhead high. We gotta stop the violence and stop living a lie. Black on black death is at an all-time high. Young hustlers die young, thinking it's the only way. Who's the city war zone? In the street, U.S. of A. Everybody's got an AK-47 rifle, an AR-15 or bloody knife. Too uncaring to care. No respect for life. Programmed for a fate of failure, nevertheless, by materialistic surface thrills and only symbols of success. Gold chains, designer clothes, a BMWs and a Mercedes-Benz. Easy money, big money, fast living, young hustlers, dead end. The object of extinction, public enemy number one, an endangered species, Mother Africa's native son. Made of a pure black gold, but programmed to self-destruct by remote control. Hi, I'm Danny Queen, and welcome to another edition of Color Me Poetry. We're here with the Honorable Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. Welcome, Dr. Walson. We're glad to have you here. And you are the author of the new ISIS papers,
right?
The new book that's really been done very well in the black community.
Yes, well, I'm glad.
I want to talk about. I want to jump right in. I want to talk about black men, and that's why I introduced that poem, because I thought that it was significant. Just things that I see, just observation.
Well, I want to praise you for you know, some of your work, all of your work,
thank you.
But
thank
you're zeroing in on some of the critical things that are happening amongst black people, babies making babies, you name it, you've written about
Loose
it.
Loose booty blues.
Okay, that these are very important, and I would encourage people to buy and read your poetry, but zeroing in on what is happening with young black men, I would say if we understand racism, we've talked about my work, the Cress Theory of Color Confrontation and Racism and the ISIS papers, and I zero in also, by understanding racism, then we can understand why black people in general are under attack, but black males in particular, because I maintain that the critical concern in the global white population, as well as the local white population, is conscious or subconscious concern about white genetic survival as the minority genetic recessive population. The threat to that genetic survival is the black male.
Historically so.
Historically, genetically. So we could go back to Greek and Roman times, 2,000 years ago, when Europe began to go into Africa, and the experience of white genetic annihilation because of the genetic dominance of people of color, and black people had the greatest genetic potential to cause white genetic annihilation. So the societal construct, most fundamentally, is an attack on black males, that when we bring it up to the 1990s, we are seeing drugs appear. Black people do not create any of the chemicals that produce the drugs, but drugs appear in the community coming from somewhere else. But since it's not black people that are producing drugs, they are coming from other than black people. The guns that are coming into the black community.
Lots of guns now.
Do you see there are 200 million guns in the society? The Wall Street Journal had an article talking about all the manufacturers of guns that are producing guns, and specific manufacturers that are producing guns that are coming specifically into the inner city. Do you see cheap guns that can be bought and made available to any young black person who is frustrated and has become overwhelmed by a system that they don't understand, but they experience being the target of attack? Do you see, through unemployment, seeing their fathers unemployed, seeing their uncles unemployed, seeing their grandfathers unemployed, and seeing that there's not supposed to be a place in the society for them to maturate and to develop, only the instruments of self-destruction. Do you see? So you've written about that in your poetry, and I consider that to be a priority topic for critical discussion amongst black people. For example, in our metropolitan area, I believe in Fairfax, Virginia, young white students in high school were fainting. 20 young people fainted. They had a massive commission with all kinds of experts to understand why children were fainting. Now, we have mass murder going on our streets. I believe Courtland Malloy had an article in the paper yesterday talking about the number of black people in South Africa that were killed since 1987, 85, or I believe 87. And we have a comparable number of black people in the District of Columbia alone.
Not to mention the other cities across
the country.
Do you see,
right, in the District of Columbia alone, where a population of less than a million people had a comparable number of deaths compared to a place where war was going on around the issue of racism. Do you see? But nobody has a commission. So that says, for the behavioral scientist who is stepping back and looking at the phenomena, when you have mass death occurring, and no one sets up a commission, it means that they want the mass death, you see, amongst those who control the power system.
So there's a structure.
In Nazi Germany, there was no commission to study why Semites of the Jewish religion were dying, you see, because that was the objective of the society, to get rid of Semites of the Jewish religion. Mm. So no commission. So that's the way. Do you see?
So what you're saying is not necessarily a conspiracy, but more or less a structure.
Well, I say there's no conspiracy. The 14th Street Bridge is standing. A conspiracy doesn't hold it up. but a structure holds it up, and that's why it functions. I don't like the concept of conspiracy. Do you see, any more than I say, it wasn't a conspiracy to destroy 11 million Semites of the Jewish religion in Germany. There was simply a governmental, do you see, a power structure plan to carry this out. The word conspiracy often sends people, oh, dismiss that. They're talking about a conspiracy. Do you see, as opposed to no, it was planning, conscious, subconscious planning that had to do with the fundamental dynamics within the society.
But all of this also affects the structure of the family, of the black family, the breakdown of the
family.
Oh, yes,
you see, because
there's no male.
Exactly. If the father is attacked, you see, if you have one father missing in a community, then any male child benefits by the father next door, the uncle next door, functioning. But when you have massive numbers of fathers missing because the fathers are attacked, you can push fathers out of families if they do not have employment. Do you see, if they're forced into unemployment or underemployment, then men become depressed, discouraged, and they leave their families out of their depression and being upset. And so this is what has happened amongst black people. And I say, going back to the Cress theory, that the attack on the black male by the system of white supremacy because of its concern about white genetic survival is what has foundationally caused the collapse of the so-called black family structure, and therefore large numbers of young male children being forced to function without father guidance. Do you see, when you have children longing for fathers and no fathers are around because the fathers have been in one or another way destroyed, and so the children gather together, one of the phenomena is they can gather together in gangs, or they can feel frightened and immature, scared, do you see, because everybody is frustrated and angry, or large numbers of people frustrated and angry and fighting, and so therefore I have to defend myself. Do you see? But we have to go back and look at what is that cause? What is the causation?
Because often we don't look at the cause. We just look at
the cause. We don't look at
it.
Now, some things we look at, what is the cause?
Yeah, and sometimes it's
right. And other things we don't. When you don't want to solve a problem, you never look for causation. Do you see? If you want the status quo to be maintained, then you start the alphabet at K instead of starting at A. Am I making, do you see?
Yeah.
If you want us to understand
start
the alphabet,
in the middle somewhere.
You start at A. Do you see? But if you want to pretend as though you are addressing the problem.
You know, that just reminds me a few years ago, this thing with David Kennedy down in Florida. You know, he died from an overdose of drug, and they had all the studies of why David didn't have his father there and didn't feel his father's love oozing through his hand.
Exactly.
Well, by the same token, how many black kids who don't have fathers too, and they don't do no study on them at all?
Do you see, if anybody just looked at the issue, what does a male child feel? Do you see, when father's not available to buy a birthday present, to buy Christmas presents, or to give general support, the deep depression that that child is in, one of the psychiatric centers I will not name in our area has an ad that comes on TV, do you see, about an adult male feeling down and depressed, and how, you know, it's so important that relatives and other people understand and call this, you know, mental health treatment center so the person can get help. Do you see? But we can have understanding for an adult who may be sad, but no understanding for a child. Do you see? When that happens, then you know that the society is really in trouble, when there is no understanding about the needs of children. Do you see? Because children are the future.
And it's very profound psychological impact upon the child, too.
Exactly. Do you see? So that for people who are genuinely interested in not just lamenting and complaining, but who say, we must understand these problems that we are determined to, then I say, put children at the top of the agenda. You see, no, we're not going to put our major effort into punishing children. We are going to see where we have failed as older people. Do you see, because children are invited to the planet. Every child, white, black, brown, red, or yellow, is invited
to the planet.
To the planet. That's like being invited to a party. Do you see? And then when you get there, you're hatcheted. as opposed to entertained and fed and allowed to be made comfortable, do you see, and feel whole.
You know, that reminds me also about the people who, the abortion issue, pro-lifers and all, and that, you know, that whole issue, so concerned about, you know, children that are yet unborn. But don't seem to be so concerned.
But the ones who are already here, you allow them to be homeless or to
right.
starve, there's a contradiction.
Yeah.
And I don't need to say any more.
And no more needs to be said about that. I want to ask you also about the your position on the chessboard.
Oh, the concept of the chessboard. Okay.
Yes.
I'm not a chess player, but, mm-hmm. you know, I read about chess and understand the concept in the game. And I say that anyone who is interested in understanding the issue of racism, white supremacy, should understand the concept of the chessboard. Because when people sit down, I mean, they have chess tournaments, national mm-hmm. chess tournaments, international chess tournaments, and people play chess without hating their opponent, do you see? But for a given game, somebody is playing the white side of the chessboard, and the other party is playing the black side of the chessboard. White always moves first, so that would be analogous to white supremacy or the domination of people of color that would be on the black side of the mm-hmm. chessboard. Now, black people heretofore have been saying, please stop, don't do this, don't do that. Do you see? It would be analogous to the person on the black side of the chessboard saying to the person on the white side of the chessboard, don't move against my position. Do you see?
Okay.
But if you understand chess and you mm-hmm. understand, no, that position, do you see the white king moving to checkmate the black king, is the name of the game.
And you have to understand.
And if you understand that, then you can play the black side of the chessboard playing defense offense. You can play to victory. Do you see? But if you think you will not win any chess tournaments thinking that you can ask your opponent, it's like on the football field. Do you see? One team mm-hmm. asking the other team to help me make mm-hmm. points, as opposed to you must analyze, first of all, the game. You must analyze all of the moves on the field or the board that will allow you to progress forward in the presence of a structured opposition. So I suggest that black people move into the 21st century with a comprehensive understanding of chess, do you see, or a comprehensive understanding of racism, white supremacy, the necessity mm-hmm. for playing for white genetic survival, and then the majority people on the planet who are looked upon as a threat to white genetic survival, do you see, playing the opposite side of the chessboard mm-hmm. for justice and peace.
Mm. Dr. Wells, we're going to take a break right here. We're going to be right back. This is Color Me Poetry.
Today, hunger will take the lives of 35,000 people, most of them children. I had the opportunity to serve on the Presidential Commission on World and Domestic Hunger. And after studying all the expert testimony, our commission found that we can end hunger in America and around the world by the year 2000. It's just a matter of public concern and political will. This is not a partisan issue. I have met with many national leaders over the years, presidents, senators, and representatives, and whether Democrat or Republican, conservative or liberal, most of them care a great deal about the hunger issue. But they need to hear from us to make ending hunger a top priority. Can you imagine America leading the world to end hunger? I can. It's up to all of us.
This is Danny Queen. Welcome back to Color Me Poetry. We're here with Dr. Frances Cress Welsing. Dr. Welsing, I wanted to say that most admire your work, and I'm not the only one, of course, that admires your work. There's, in the record industry, there's many, many groups in the rap industry, because, you know, rap is very big, you know,
yes.
right now. Years ago, they didn't think rap was going to be big. Matter of fact, a lot of the so-called officials in the record industry say, well, it ain't nothing. This is a flash in the pan.
Mm-hmm.
But rap has become very, very big, so much so now that you see white rap artists also, you know, getting into the picture.
Huh? Yes.
And you've had a lot of influence on rappers such as Public Enemy. I mean, Public Enemy is really put the message. As I remember, there's a record company out of Philadelphia that says their motto is, there's a message in our music.
Okay.
And I think they've definitely have done that. Would you respond to that?
Well, Public Enemy, when they did Fear of the Black Planet,
mm-hmm.
there was apparently a lot of discussion. I did not know the young people didn't know any rappers. Mm. And people, you know, calling me from all over newspapers. Well, how did Public Enemy, how do they know about you? Or how were you involved with them? Well, I wasn't involved, but the young mm-hmm. people apparently read the Cress Theory.
They picked up on it.
And picked up on it, and they have informed me that that's where the title, Fear of the Black Planet, meaning fear of white genetic annihilation, that would be what I, how I would interpret it. Mm. So that's where...
That lets you know that the message is getting out there. And if young people can pick that up and put that on to the ribbon, and music and rhyme.
You see, well, what was fascinating to me was that people didn't say this is interesting in a positive way.
Mm.
This is interesting in a negative, that this is something
they
say to suppress.
The
this is my impression from some of the things that newspapers that called me were indicating, certainly for me it was a positive thing, because since black people are particular victims of racism, white supremacy, that older black people and younger black people need to understand this so that they can function more effectively in the society and in the world, understanding what the dynamic of forces are that impact on their lives, that everybody should want that for children or young people to understand, because I maintain that black people, you know, many times we greet each other by saying what's happening because we haven't understood what was going on. And so we're constantly raising the question. Now when young black people begin to understand, that should be mm-hmm. cause for rejoicing, not lamenting.
Mm, but when you're on the other side of the board.
When you're on the other side of the board, right, if somebody
like
playing the white side of the chessboard is in fear that they may be overpowered by the black side of the chessboard, they might try to confuse the person playing that side of the board as to where, you know, what particular opening and what particular strategy and tactics being employed.
I've often had people say to me, white and black, that I'm militant, my writing, you're so militant, you're so straightforward, you know. And to me, it's normal. I mean, I don't see it as being militant at all.
Well, again, you see, if you understand power structures, and that's why the game of chess is so very important, because everything is related to power and the construct of power and the maintenance of power and the refinement of power. And so that in a construct, do you see, of mm-hmm. white power and the oppression of non-white, then the victim is supposed to be, you know, like a slave, not reason, not think, not speak up. And so if you speak up about the construct of power, there's a chance that you may be labeled militant or irresponsible mm-hmm. or what's the favorite word, controversial.
Yes.
Do you see, but those labels...
I'm sure they put those labels
come about,
on you.
Well, I've heard some of those labels before, but mm-hmm. it has nothing to do with the bigger issue of solving the problem of injustice or the degradation of the large number of human beings on the planet.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you said that, because as an artist, many people have said that type of thing to me, mm-hmm. That I ought to write about the birds and the bees and nature poetry.
Mm-hmm.
I have nothing against nature poetry at all. I
mm-hmm.
love it.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to deal with many other different things, many different types of things. I want to deal with real problems. I don't like writing about something off on the tangent when nobody knows what you're really talking about.
Well, sometimes, I know in my practice of psychiatry, mm-hmm. sometimes you have to help patients understand if it's a big white elephant sitting in the middle of the room, you don't talk around the edge of the elephant and not mm-hmm. talk about the presence of the elephant. DC, but sometimes it is frightening or disturbing for people to deal with reality. But I was told when I trained as a psychiatrist, the role of the psychiatrist is to help people deal with reality, even when they are afraid and believe that they cannot deal with that reality, because there cannot be any mental health functioning by ignoring reality or distorting reality. Indeed, we call people psychotic, who cannot deal with reality,
mm-hmm.
you know, who have to call fire roses. Do you see? So somebody wants you to write about roses when there's a fire. but you persist in talking about fire, because if you don't talk about the fire, everybody gets burned up.
It's just like it's kind of like it's a part of me. I feel like it's something that I've always wanted to do. You know, when I was in school, even before I went to college, I always knew what I wanted to do. I always wanted to write.
Okay.
So I make sacrifices so I can do that, so I can write.
Well, that's very important. See, that's like a manifestation of self-respect. You feel something inside, and you persist knowing that your purpose on the planet is to do that particular thing.
And that's exactly how I feel. So I move on that, and I don't look for family and friends to support me. It's nice they did, but I have to know it for myself. This is what I'm here to do, and I'm going to do this. And I'm use the art form to do it.
Do you see? That's wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Also, I wanted to ask concerning children. There's an epidemic, I understand, in South Carolina, where there's an epidemic of deficiency in the children's...
Maybe you mean attention deficit disorder?
Deficit disorder. Can you speak on that? Because a friend of mine was asking about that, and I didn't really understand. And the situation is that there's a young child who's in school, a student in school, and they want to put him on some medication.
Well, one could look across the country and see situations in which non-white children, whether they're black or Hispanic, someone is saying, well, they're hyperactive. They're too active. Put them on medication. Sometimes that is related to teachers, non-black teachers, who are not tuned into and deeply caring for non-white children. And so the very activity, they don't know how to relate to the children in order to help the children, you know, calm down and settle down and to do their work. But it's been my experience that sometimes a child that will be labeled as hyperactive, do you see, by a non-black person, the parents don't see the child, no one sees the child as being too active, other than a particular person says, I think he needs to be on medication. That should be the last thing that is recommended for children. But again, within our societal construct, do you see? And then when we begin to think about the larger picture of black young people being placed on drugs, by drugs being made available to them, do you see? And there's
all
some black thinkers and scholars who say, oh, instead of the people being active and conscious when there are no jobs or there are no decent housing, do you see, then you put them on drugs that will calm them down. So we need to, anytime that is recommended, it needs to be calmly
questioned,
seriously questioned, and assessed exactly what are you talking about. And if the same behavior, do you see, sometimes in some situations in the dominant culture, when children are assertive and inquisitive and moving around, that is looked at as a plus. Do you see? But
not dealing with
on
us.
The other side of the board, if there is activity and inquisitiveness, then that is perceived as a problem.
But that's a natural inclination for all children.
Well, in other words, right, you want children to be alert and to be thinking and experiencing their world, and adults helping them understand their world and understand behaviors that will be constructive to their goal objectives in the world. We don't have that world yet.
Well, oftentimes the things that adults put on children are often are hindrances in many, many ways. Child's mind is like a sponge. It's always absorbing knowledge and information. It wants to know. But sometimes...
Someone told me recently, this is a school in the District of Columbia, where a teacher had a name sounded like a Polish name or from Eastern Europe, and the teacher was in a black school, elementary school, and the teacher told the children to just call her by this short name because they would not have the ability to pronounce a name with, you know, 10 letters. Now, that says something very significant. Instead of the teacher writing the name on the board and saying that this is the way to correctly pronounce my name. I'm sure that you boys and girls, do you see, have the intelligence, if my name was twice as long, to to pronounce
she decided that they can't.
She decided. You see, now the implications are very grave, because if a child cannot learn how to pronounce a name with four syllables, then what, I mean, if you think that, then mm-hmm. what is your expectation
of the child.
In terms of this child mm-hmm. proceeding to understand trigonometry and calculus, advanced algebra? Do you see, or the child saying, I think I want to be a space scientist. Well, if I'm thinking you cannot pronounce a four-syllable name, then I will say, no, I don't think that you should strive for that. Had you thought about, I don't know what to say, but you
janitor.
Know, well, do you see, I don't want to demean any work.
Yeah.
Do you see? But that is a very, I myself was told, I don't think you should think about being a physician. I think you, why not think about clerical work? This is in a college. Do you see, if I hadn't had a background of parents saying, yes, you're going to be a doctor, or grandparents,
enforcing it.
Or, you know, teachers in the black community say you can be whatever you decide that you want to be. But that is a part of our societal structure that still says in many high places mm-hmm. that black people do not have the
capacity.
Genetic capacity to do this, that, or the other. That's and we have to understand that that's a byproduct of racist thinking, conscious or subconscious.
That's their thinking, and it certainly does not have to be ours. Mm-hmm. In the last few minutes, I would like for you to, if you will, just give us some things, if you will, for the black nation that we ought to strive for.
Well, we were going to talk about rap just briefly, so I'll throw that in as we close, that there's a lot of negative discussion
about rap.
In rap, in the music itself. Mm-hmm.
The industry.
Okay, there's conscious political awareness, but there's some in which there's very negative, do you see, discussion
That's
about
true.
People. Bright, intelligent young people who are creating this, but I say without conscious understanding of how the society may have made them feel about themselves, do you see, so that there might be negative information about sex. Western culture has a lot of negative information
concerning
about sex, and I mm-hmm. translate that as having negative ideas about self. Do you see, let's say white people want a suntan, that's a negative attitude about white skin. Do you see, so that the culture would then produce pornography or negative views about sex, which is the act of self-reproduction. Then black people have picked this up. There were not negative attitudes about sex in Africa, do you see, but young people in some instances in rap music are saying negative things about the act of self-reproduction or sex. And this is something that we need to begin thinking about. Okay. Or other negative language.
Because rap has a tremendous impact.
It has a tremendous impact. You see, that's that right. whole rhythm, putting language, music. I mean, thinking concepts in rhythm. Mm-hmm. Do you see, using both sides of the cerebral cortex right. is a very efficient way
Certainly.
To learn. So many things could go in that are positive and constructive, and you know, older
Make
people and younger people need That's to right. look for those positive messages.
Thank you very much, Dr. Welsing, for being with us here on Color Me Poetry. Certainly look forward to you coming back and sharing with us, and the book will continue to do well because we're going to go out and buy it. I certainly thank you so very much. This is Danny Queens, Color Me Poetry, and until next time, Color Me Poetry.
evening, Queen. Welcome to another exciting edition of Color Me Poetry. I'd like to welcome my guest, Mr. Nelly Fuller. He's the author of a book entitled Textbook for Victims of White Supremacy, Racism, if you will. Welcome, Mr. Fuller. Welcome for the second time.
Greetings.
It's certainly great to have you back with us again, and we're talking about the textbook and what the textbook is. Tell us a little bit about the textbook and simply how you got started. Then we can take it to a whole other level, if you will.
Well, the book was started to fill a vacuum. That's why I call it the compensatory code system concept. Mm-hmm. And compensatory means making up for what's missing. Now, what's missing is a solution or suggestions mm-hmm. for a solution to what we call racism, mm-hmm. which you have to put that in the frame of reference of the most potent mm-hmm. kind, the only functional kind, and that is what we call loosely white supremacy. And hopefully to replace it with a commodity that's never been produced called justice. And that's what the compensatory logic comes from, meaning you're making up, you do things, mm-hmm. you say things, thought, speech, and action to compensate for the existence of something that should not exist. You take one thing out of existence and bring something better into existence. Hopefully that would be justice, which would also couple with correctness, which means balance between people and things, creatures, etc., the air, the environment, mm-hmm. etc. And then, theoretically, that would bring on what many people have spoken about for many years, and that is peace. You put that in quotes, mm-hmm. because functionally there is no way for people to know what peace is. The world mm-hmm. has never known peace.
Peace, yes.
But you can't have justice, correctness, or peace without first removing racism, because racism is a form of royalism that will guarantee that you can't have peace in any area of activity.
What are the five things, five basic words to describe what needs to be done?
Well, when you put it in the frame of reference, everyone, when they talk about racism and our white supremacy, should always start by saying that the focus, the objective should be replace white supremacy mm-hmm. with justice. Those are the five basic words. Mm-hmm. And you start your frame of reference from that. The words are very important, because when people talk about racism, mm-hmm. they tend to get away from the basic focus. If you keep those five words in mind, replace white supremacy with justice, then you can keep focus. In many of these discussions on the matter, people tend to get into everything from feminism to words that don't have precise
communism
definitions.
Communism and everything else, they go off
yes.
on a tangent.
Yes, right.
Yeah, but this kind of locks it in.
Right, bigotry, discrimination, sexism, a multitude of isms, biracialism, whatever that means, multiculturalism.
Whatever that means.
Yes, and so you get into a myriad of words mm-hmm. that don't apply to the focus of what you're talking about. So therefore, that is the basic frame of reference that you should always focus on. That should be used by all people mm-hmm. who are talking about the problem as it is.
Mm-hmm. What is the tragic arrangement, or the three T's, if you will, and what are some of the first two things that must be done to establish quality relationship between white and non-white people, if you will?
Well, the three T's called a tragic arrangement mm-hmm. are tacky, trashy, terroristic. Now, this is the arrangement
okay.
that non-white people on this planet have with white people in their everyday interactions in all areas of activity.
Tacky,
trashy, and terroristic. One of the three. It doesn't get any better than tacky. Mm. If you will observe black people, for instance, in the presence of white people, on account of the way that both of them are raised mm-hmm. within the system of white supremacy, there is a strain there. There is not a even flow. Okay. So what you have is a tackiness. It doesn't get any better than tacky. It can't get any better than tacky within the system of white supremacy.
Why?
So this is all very tragic. Well, because the system of white supremacy the demands that mm-hmm. white people interact with non-white people in a certain way that is mm-hmm. harmful and harsh and overall destructive. Mm. And that the non-white people interact with the white people in the same manner. And they are taught this, mm-hmm. both people.
Are taught this
at a very early age, and then the teaching goes on every day in all nine areas of activity: economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war.
All areas of people activity.
Mm. All of the areas mm-hmm. of people activity, you know, everywhere in the known universe.
You know, I noticed something. I used to work with a gentleman, elderly gentleman, and whenever he would come in contact with white people, he always had a tendency to have to be the entertainment committee to make everybody laugh. If we were on the elevator or doing something in the building, he was always the person to make white people laugh. He was always the clown.
Yes.
I always kept a straight face, so he thought something was wrong with me.
Yes, well, you can tell that there's a strain even on college campuses and whatnot mm-hmm. and in schools. The people will go to the classes together because that's where the classes are. That's where the teaching is. And then the students will separate themselves in the lunchroom. Now, there's a reason for that, mm-hmm. and the reason is not healthy. It shows that something is completely, completely out of order. Mm-hmm. Because if the people are sharing the same classroom and learning the same things and having the same values that are taught in that classroom, then why do not the people interact with each other in all of the areas of activity without exception in harmony?
Well, maybe they're not learning the same thing.
That is it.
Maybe they taught the same thing, but yes, not necessarily learning the same thing.
That is it. Under the system of white supremacy, a black student sitting next to a white student mm-hmm. is being taught how to be a victim of white supremacy. The white person, the white student, mm-hmm. is being taught how to be a white supremacist.
And it's all in the language.
This is done in the language, in the use of the words, in the subject matter of the materials, if the material in any way mm-hmm. relates to interactions between people. Mm. Now, the other two T's, trashy, if you try to improve on the tackiness, mm-hmm. then it gets trashy,
meaning
the interactions
what?
Between. For instance, you can say that in the area of religion, mm-hmm. Sunday morning, black people and white people do not attend the same churches.
Dr. King said the most segregated hour in America.
Right. Now, that is tacky, particularly in the area of religion. It should mm-hmm. not be. Mm-hmm. The two people should come together in religion, if in nothing else, it would seem logically speaking. Mm-hmm. But under the system of racism, since the basic teaching of mm-hmm. the white supremacy system mm-hmm. is that white supremacy is a religion, so you have a built-in barrier
already
against black people and white people sharing the same premises and preaching the same gospel and talking about loving each other and treating each other with justice. So therefore, you can't have what you call mm-hmm. black people and white people in the same religious setting, which is why you don't have it.
So what you do have,
and I'd like to add this, mm-hmm. is the trashiness that goes on the same Sunday morning, mm-hmm. and that is maybe in the houses of prostitution, mm-hmm. in the houses of dope dealing. Then you will have black and white together.
That's the only same
day,
place.
On Sunday.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's interesting that you would say that, because you have these two groups, and we both say we're Christian. We have white Baptists, then we have black Baptists, and we're supposed to be worshiping the same God, if you will.
Yes, one in Christ, they often say. Mm-hmm. And that is something that not even many black people care to explain. Mm-hmm. That they say we are, you know, in Christ there is no east, no west, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yet, the black people and the white people cannot mm-hmm. sit down in the same bench in a mm-hmm. church.
I find it interesting, speaking of religion, that you could have Billy Graham come to town and all the black ministers start bowing down. Minister Louis Farrakhan comes and there's controversy.
Well, that is because of the race issue.
Mm-hmm, as well.
It's always because of the race issue. You can't do anything. You can't straighten out anything in religion or any of the nine areas of activity without first eliminating racism. Mm-hmm. And here again, there's only one functional form and that is white supremacy.
Mm-hmm. What should be used as a role model for replacing white supremacy?
The role model for replacing white supremacy mm-hmm. should be a code of thought, speech, and action, not a person, never a person. And that also applies to producing justice throughout the world, which justice has never been produced, as far as anyone who is existing now knows anything about. We don't know what justice would be like. We don't know what peace would be like.
Yes.
Never had it. So in the process of producing justice, you need a role model, and that role model has to be a prescription. Mm-hmm. Some ministers have said in the beginning there was the word. Now,
yes.
that certainly applies also mm-hmm. to straightening out race problems. You have to have the words. The words are not correct. Hardly any of the words are correct. The words are designed to support racism. And this is why you have the confusion you have in the schools.
Deceit.
Yes, the deceit. Mm-hmm. See, the words are designed to support deceit, which is the basic tool of the white supremacists.
Mm-hmm.
So your role model would be a code that is designed to counteract all of the words, a code of thought, speech, and action, all of the words, first of all, and then the deeds mm-hmm. that would counteract what is already in place, which mm-hmm. is injustice.
What is VGQ? I mean, what does that mean?
That is a term that recently mm-hmm. I coined that means, so people can remember it easily, the VGQ means Victims Guaranteed Qualification. And the purpose of this is to minimize and or eliminate unnecessary conflict between the victims of racism in their confusion of trying to do something about it, like end it and replace it with justice. Mm-hmm. And the VGQ means you're guaranteed the qualification. You're the victim of white supremacy.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the victim means. You're guaranteed the qualification to say anything that you want to say mm-hmm. about race, racism, or counter-racism. By being a victim, you're guaranteed that qualification. You're guaranteed from birth that qualification. So therefore, no non-white person can tell another non-white person mm-hmm. what to say, what not to say, and how to say it on the issue of race, racism, or counter-racism. Mm. Because no non-white person is qualified to tell another non-white person
what
this.
It is to be a victim.
Reason being, mm-hmm. all are equal victims.
Right. You know, I'm glad you said that, because oftentimes, particularly in the news, you know, with the media, mother media, if you will oftentimes pit one person of color against the other. Well, Mr. Farrakhan said this, so what do you think? You know, and they want some other black person to comment or condemn somebody else for saying
not qualified.
Something.
Mm-hmm. Nelly Fuller is not qualified to say what Mr. Queen can mm-hmm. say or not say mm-hmm. in regards to race, racism, or counter-racism. Any other non-white person. Now, you can mm-hmm. raise questions, or you're qualified to say things to white people about mm-hmm. things that are said about race, racism, or counter-racism. Reason being, white people are not victims of white supremacy.
That's the difference. Can you hold that point right there? We have to take a break. Danny Queen, we'll be right back.
When Raymond was six, I was afraid to take him to the playground because they were doing drugs. When he was 10, I couldn't let him play ball in the schoolyard because of the gangs. When he was 15, I wouldn't let him go to any dances because there could be a fight or a shooting. Now he's a man, and I realize he's never been a kid.
Give your children back their childhood. Do something now. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT. Together, we will take a bite out of crime.
All right. Yeah, they're gonna win. Are you scared of flying?
No.
Good. 5:33.
If you don't stop your friend from driving drunk, who will?
Go ask the man what gates to Chicago.
Do whatever it takes.
Hi, I'm Danny Queen. Welcome back to Color Me Poetry. I'd like to welcome back my guest, Mr. Nelly Fuller. He's the author of the book,
of the textbook for victims of white supremacy, if you will, and this is our book of the month. We ask that you go out and buy it. It's a wonderful book. It will change your life. It'll change your mind about a whole lot of things. Mr. Fuller, just before we took the break, we were talking about racism, of course, and you were saying that white people are not the victims of white supremacy. They're the perpetrators of it. Is that right?
Yes, but that's not presumably all white people. It is against counter-racist logic, if you will, or the counter-racist code or compensatory code to say that, to say that all white people are racist.
Yes.
No person can presume that they know all white people.
So how did you say that?
Even most white people are racist.
So what would you say?
What the correct thing to say is those who are.
Okay.
And those who are more powerful and smarter than those who aren't. Why? Because the evidence shows it. Otherwise, you would have no such thing as white supremacy, as if the white people who did not believe in white supremacy were not as smart, and not the white people who did believe in white supremacy were not as smart, and therefore not as powerful as those who did not.
Now, you get problems from black people when you say that, though, when you say that white people are the smartest people in the universe. And because they're going to say, well, are you saying all white people are the smartest people in the universe?
Well, you look at it within the context of the system of white supremacy itself, the system of white supremacy being in capital letters. And you can make a metaphor, probably, of a prison system. The warden is always smarter than the prisoner, always. Because the system of racism is a prison system. It imprisons people, imprisons their minds, imprisons their ambitions. People know instinctively that they are restricted. It's a requirement of the system to restrict people on the basis of color. It's an artificial thing that was thought up, the grandest idea ever thought of for controlling people and getting things done. And a lot of things can be accomplished with the system, but too many people are mistreated because of it.
They could have mistreated people based upon a lot of things, but they
based
chose color.
Based on foot size, but someone chose color.
Okay.
And it turned out to be the grandest and most effective idea for getting things done that was ever thought up. This is why the white supremacists are the smartest people in the world. They thought this up and they put it into execution, and it was able to accomplish more in a shorter period of time than any idea that had ever been thought up before. It is really a advanced system of royalism based on the old royal principle of kings and queens, etc.
Now, Ms. Fuller, is it ever correct to say that the Americans, the CIA, the FBI, the police, the establishment, is it ever correct to say that in counter-racist codification?
It's never correct to accuse those entities by that language of being racist.
Okay.
No FBI, no CIA, no police officer is a racist and or a white supremacist. Now, the correct language is always, without exception, a white supremacist is a racist is a white supremacist, and the name of the organization is either the white nation, quote unquote, or the system of white supremacy. That's the way it's always described. The white people who practice white supremacy do not belong to nations. They have no allegiance to anything except the system of white supremacy. They have no allegiance to a police force. A police officer is a person that believes in practicing justice. And keep that in mind. It's important to keep in mind.
Supposed to be.
Yes. A person who aspires to be an American would also believe in justice. So a white supremacist can't be an American, and an American cannot be a white supremacist.
Why?
So the language has to be precise, because a white supremacist only has allegiance to the system of white supremacy,
so
not Americanism.
Therefore, white supremacists could be anybody.
a white supremacist, first of all, would have to be a white person who has chosen to participate in the system of white supremacy. That's a choice that every white person has to make at an early age. And they make that choice once they become aware that there are people of different colors in the world. And then they mostly pick it up by osmosis and by the training that they get in schools and with their associates, which way to go, either to be a racist or not to be a racist.
That is the question.
Yes, and it's very difficult for a white person born into the universe as it is now to not be a racist. Extremely difficult and extremely costly.
To go against the grain.
Yes,
yes,
because it means like going against organized crime when you're born into an
crime
organized
family.
Yes, a criminal enterprise, and you're going against the family. It's a no-no.
Now, most white people know, they all know that it's better in this society and, if you will, the world, to be white than it is to be non-white.
Yes, that's why it's a profitable thing. You when you have to make your choice, if you're a white person, it is a pretty easy choice to make to go along with the status quo because the status quo is profitable. To go against that means that you're going to be in big trouble with other members of the organization, and they naturally have all the power. Now, there are white people, the question is raised, well, there are white people who are in poverty, and so what about them? Are they a part of the organization? Yes, because it's still an advantage to be white.
Yeah,
even
if
when
you're
in poverty,
white.
Even when you are what they call, quote, unquote, in poverty. And a white person generally knows that instinctively.
Or what
and
other
by
white,
observation.
Or what other white people call poor white trash.
Yes. Yes, it's it's better to be in that category because your possibilities of getting out of that category
and
are much greater.
They would tell you that too, though.
Well, some of them, those who would tell the truth. Now, that's one thing that's really missing in the discussion on racism. So few people are willing to tell the truth.
Truth, yes. That's true. That's I guess that goes back to what you're saying because they know it's the advantage to, well, to not tell them the truth and, you know, to go on
deceit,
the status quo.
Deceit, the forked tongue, as the people who are called Indians are called, is your basic glue that holds the system of white supremacy together. This is why words have to be used in a certain way, according to the code, to counteract the words that are used that makes the glue that holds the system of racism together. Once that system begins to fall apart, it will be primarily because of the failure of the language to hold it together. And that's the job of the people who are opposed to racism to decode the language and start using the correct language.
Why does a code book what does the compensatory code book prescribe? No sexual intercourse or sex play between white and non-white people until racism is over?
For just that reason. As long as you have the system of white supremacy in place, if you have sexual intercourse and or sexual play between white people and non-white people, it only makes what is strong already stronger. In other words, the white person becomes more powerful and a racist in that interaction, and the non-white person becomes more victimized.
Whether they know it or not.
Whether they know it or not, because of the system of white supremacy is already in place. Case in point is a story like Pocahontas, etc. When you are subject people and you have sexual intercourse with the people that you are subject to, then you are being taken advantage of. It is the same relationship that you have between a person who is the head of a mental institution who is taking advantage of the patients sexually. Or in the case of some other type of institution where an older person takes advantage of a younger person, what we now call pedophiles. It's the same basic interaction.
So you're saying there's no balance?
No balance whatsoever. And actually it's a cruel act. It's an act of direct racist aggression against the non-white person. Sexual intercourse and or sexual play between a white person and a non-white person within the system of white supremacy.
And we all within
and
it.
And we all within it.
Mm-hmm.
Makes the non-white person more victimized because mm-hmm. the sex act is not just a physical act. It is also a mental act. Mm-hmm. And so the non-white person gets out of that bed, if that is the locale of mm-hmm. the sexual intercourse or sexual play, with a damaged mind. Because now they are more confused than they were before. It's just like a underage individual being taken sexual advantage of, and the individual becomes more confused because the individual really doesn't know too much about what's going on in the big picture. They know about the act, but they don't know the significance of the act.
And that's a very, very significant point.
Yes.
And what area of the principle is that, of the nine principles? That's number eight, is that right?
That comes under the eighth area of activity, right? Out of the nine, sex.
And very, very powerful.
Very powerful.
I wish we had more time to expound on.
Yes, sex is a very powerful instrument mm-hmm. that the races have always used.
Mm. What is the best or correct way for non-white people to conduct themselves with each other?
Minimize the conflict by minimizing contact. That is the non-white people. Non-white people are damaged, severely damaged. In fact, the system for white supremacy turns out two types of non-white people, two types of black people, monsters and monstrosities, just being in the system of white supremacy and subject to it makes you a monstrosity. You act weird. You do strange things. You do things that don't make sense. You say things that don't make sense. Your entire view of the world does not make sense. And then you become monstrous when it reaches the extreme.
Mm-hmm.
You do things like kill people.
Yes.
Rob people, just go on rampages, etc.
What are the four basic ways that black and white people should use all their time and energy?
Well, okay. That's the time and energy usage. That's under economics, the first area of activity.
In other words, what should non-white people do with their time?
Produce, clean, repair anything of constructive value to use for constructive purposes. Go into some type of business. Anything that is constructive, that's the use of time and energy. That's number one. Number two is you exchange views, like we're doing now, about ways and means of ending racism and replacing it with justice. Also, number three is that you eat and sleep correctly, only as necessary. Number four, sexual intercourse, but no more than twice every 7 days.
Mr. Fuller, we certainly thank you for coming and sharing with us. Unfortunately, we're out of town. We've been talking with Mr. Nelly Fuller. He's the author of the book, Textbook for Victims of White Supremacy. And how can we get in touch with you, sir?
You can get in touch with me by calling 202-484-5461, and that's for speaking engagements and et cetera.
Now, your book can be purchased at Pyramid Books, Yawa Books, Caravan, Everyone's Place in Baltimore, Caribou, and North Star Books. We ask that you go out and buy Mr. Fuller's book. It's a great book. It's called Textbook for Victims of White Supremacy. Mr. Fuller, we thank you for coming and sharing with us, sir, here on Color Me Poetry, and we're certainly going to have you back. Thank you for coming and sharing with us. I'm Danny Queen. This is Color Me Poetry. Until next time, Color Me Poetry.